We're standing in Via Tornabuoni in Florence. Take a look at this medieval stronghold, an imposing home built by a wealthy Florentine in the 1290s. A stone's throw away is this grand family home, built a couple centuries later in the Renaissance. You can feel how people's entire approach to the world has changed. Florentines rediscovered ancient civilization and tried to recapture its sense of order and elegance. But this video isn't about that. It's not about the Renaissance, because although Florence is filled with Renaissance treasures, it's not a Renaissance city. Let me show you what I mean. I've climbed a hill on the other side of the city for one of the most spectacular views over Florence. Many scholars say the Renaissance began here in 1401, so let's look for landmarks built after that year. Okay, let's make this easier by removing the much older Basilica of Santa Croce. Then the very medieval city hall, Palazzo Vecchio, should go too. And most of the Ponte Vecchio is medieval. The Campanile was built in the Middle Ages, and so were the other towers near it. Come to think of it, most of the cathedral was built before 1401. So there's what I mean. So much of what makes Florence Florence is actually medieval. Florence didn't become an important city in the Renaissance, and it didn't become an important city because of the Medici. Cosimo, the first important Medici, was only 12 years old in 1401. By then, Florence had been an important city for almost 200 years. And it wasn't just a city, it was the capital of a republic in which prominent families made decisions and laws collectively. But when you think of the Middle Ages, you probably think of knights and French and English kings, not of Florence. So let's look at Westminster Abbey in London, where English kings have been crowned for centuries. Here's Florence Cathedral at the same scale, planned and largely completed in the same years. Or look at Rheims, where French kings were coronated. Or Notre Dame in Paris. Florence Cathedral is at least as majestic as these kingly churches, and in height and floor area, considerably larger. And Rome? Nothing in medieval Rome could compare in size or majesty with the Duomo. And amazingly, the medieval Florentine Republic was small, around the size of modern-day Luxembourg, with maybe 200,000 inhabitants. But it was an international hub of the clothing trade. It was the financial center of the world since minting the gold florin in 1251, and it was educated, with probably the highest literacy rate in the world at that time. Siena was another thriving city, a half-day's journey south by horse. Siena's twisting streets feel medieval in a way that Florence doesn't. But paradoxically, that's partly because Florence is older than Siena. The Romans who founded Florence designed a neat grid of city streets that has lasted to the present day, and built it on a river, a defining feature of many modern cities. Siena and Florence were powerful rivals with vibrant artistic cultures. But then, in 1348, the Black Plague hit, killing more than half the inhabitants of both cities. Some scholars estimate casualties as high as 80%. Grief and cultural conservatism beset the devastated cities for decades. But whereas the Sienese had to give up on a plan of expanding their cathedral, the Florentines still had the wealth and resilience to pursue their ambitions. Shortly after the plague subsided, they decided their half-built cathedral and the dome they intended for it would be even larger. And this took some real gumption. While they could paint the church they dreamed of, they had no idea how to build it. So that's the story of the Renaissance. It unfolded when one of the greatest cities in the world, the capital of a republic, recovered from the ravages of plague and found the energy and creativity for a second act. Since Florence was already quite developed, Renaissance monuments in the city were generally projects to restore, complement, or complete medieval ones. The big exception is the Palazzi, the homes of the rich, like the one we saw at the beginning of this video, which were built anew and really did change the streetscape of Florence, if not the panoramas. Let's talk about how the Medici fit into this story. Now, their rise augmented the Florentine Renaissance, no doubt. But perhaps their cultural contributions make us forget that their struggle for power ultimately extinguished both the Florentine and Sienese republics, replacing them with one-man rule. The way the later Medici treated Florence was grotesque. They turned the city hall, where Florentines had steered the Republic for centuries, into their personal apartments. They built a fortress, never actually needed to defend the city, on a high hill overlooking Florence, a reminder everywhere of their dominance. Their Palazzo Pitti is absurdly huge, many times larger than the White House. In fact, it's so big that, as you can see, the cathedral itself could fit within its wings. It's almost as wide as the United States Capitol. And remember, this was the Medici's home, one of many. Now that's the trouble with dynastic rule. You start out with cultured power brokers, but eventually you end up with megalomaniac strongmen. Today, tourists think of Florence as a charming outdoor museum. But it's a substantial city. By population, it's 3/4 the size of Atlanta, and the area that Florence has authority over is much larger, home to more than 1 million people. Florentines take pride in their history while finding ways to thrive in the present. And their heritage attracts unique characters from all over Italy and all over the world. The mayor of Florence is young, progressive, and dynamic, a violinist, and a champion of education, the environment, and equal rights. A prestigious university and new startup hubs help Florentines stay active in today's technological world. And while tourists obviously have a strong presence, young Florentines fill Piazza della Repubblica on Friday nights, and older Florentines support a busy calendar of music and theater. This great city, now in its fourth or fifth act, remains a place to live well and stay hopeful for the future.